In the video today, we are answering a viewer question because Jeremy A. asks us, why is stress bad for you? Shouldn't we have evolved to not get stressed given it's harmful? Stress in general comes in a few different forms: acute, episodic, and chronic. Acute stress can be very beneficial to you. Have you ever come face to face with a rabid puma? If so, the ability of your body to react quickly can be very beneficial. Too much stress, like in the case of episodic or chronic, can lead to a host of psychological and medical problems. So, what exactly is happening in your body when you get stressed? Well, stress begins when the danger is perceived. The signal is initially sent to an area of the brain called the amygdala. This almond-shaped grouping of neurons processes the information, and if it senses danger, it sends a distress signal to your hypothalamus. The hypothalamus plays a critical role in keeping the body's many systems in a state of homeostasis, basically acting as a connector between the endocrine system and your autonomic nervous system. The connection regulates the body's many requirements, maintaining them in a state of equilibrium, including things like body temperature, sleep cycle, sex drive, blood pressure, heart rate, thirst, production of digestive juices, and in the case of stress, stimulating your sympathetic nervous system. Commonly known as your fight or flight nervous system, when the amygdala sends its distress signal to the hypothalamus responds by sending a message down your autonomic nerves to your adrenal glands. Located above your kidneys, these glands immediately send out a hormone called epinephrine, sometimes referred to as adrenaline. This hormone also belongs to a class of neurotransmitters, the things that allow your nerves to communicate with each other, called catecholamines. Epinephrine isn't the only catecholamine released in response to stress. Dopamine and norepinephrine are also secreted. Together, these neurotransmitters do several things within the brain. For instance, they cause the release of a small protein called neuropeptide S, which decreases sleep and increases alertness, sometimes giving you a sense of anxiety. They also affect memory by suppressing short-term memory while simultaneously signaling your hippocampus to store information in your long-term memory. This allows you to react quickly, but it makes it difficult to perform intellectual tasks, and it interferes in social skills and behaviors. Your body's other responses to these catecholamines are both complex and immediate. Your blood vessels, they begin constricting, while simultaneously your heart rate increases. Your breathing rate increases, while at the same time the small airways in your lungs expand. Blood sugar is released from the many stored areas of the body supplying the energy needs. The result is an increase in blood and oxygen being pumped to the many muscles and organs of the body. This, of course, is all very, very important if you're trying to escape from a rabid puma. Some studies suggest that your blood flow might actually increase by 300 to 400%. If all of this seems like it would take way too long to happen in a beneficial way, do not fear. The reactions by your amygdala and hypothalamus are so fast, the neurotransmitters and hormones start their cascade of security before the visual centers of the brain have even processed consciously the information they've received. This is nature's way of giving you a head start when faced with the sudden onslaught of a carnivorous creature. Your hypothalamus causing your adrenal glands to release catecholamines is only a small part of the stress response. The body reacts to stress, fear, and worry in a much more all-encompassing way. Known as your HPA axis, this stress response involves a connection between your hypothalamus, pituitary, and your adrenal glands. Once the instinctual reactions caused by the catecholamines begin causing you to fight or flight, other hormonal signals continue giving you all of the benefits needed to maintain your panic-like state. At the same time catecholamines are released, your hypothalamus also begins secreting corticotropin-releasing factor. This hormone then attaches to your pituitary glands and causes it to release adrenocorticotropic hormone. Once in your circulatory system, it attaches to your adrenal cortex, causing the release of glucocorticoids, primarily cortisol. Cortisol is a steroid hormone. Its primary functions include increasing blood sugar, suppressing your immune system, and aiding in the metabolism of fats, proteins, and carbohydrates. It's also important in regulating several body systems, including the heart, lungs, circulation, metabolism, immune system, and the skin. Cortisol also reduces the effects of parts of the immune system, thereby allowing white blood cells and other molecules to propagate in areas where injury will most likely occur, like your skin and your lymph nodes. The activation of your fight-or-flight nervous system also reduces the effects of your parasympathetic nervous system, commonly known as your rest-and-digest nervous system. The consequence is a reduction in the effects of your digestive system. You might also get a dry mouth and throat caused by blood flow being diverted to more essential areas of the body. The resulting skin responses include cool, clammy, sometimes sweaty skin. Your scalp will also tighten, causing some hair to stand up. As you can see by this tour of the science behind what's happening in your body when you feel stress, if you needed your body to fight off a crazy cat, these responses can be absolutely life-saving. However, problems arise when these responses happen consistently throughout our lives, or when the danger is perceived and not actually real. As previously mentioned, the stress response is activated when there is a real or a perceived threat to homeostasis. They can also be external or internal. Real external stresses can be things like the rabid puma, painful stimuli, or stressful psychological environments such as poor working conditions, unhappy marriages, or when one is having financial problems. Real internal stresses can be things like infection, illness, or inflammation. Some studies have shown perceived stress, like when simply thinking or focusing on those real stressful situations, or continually rehashing stresses from the past, causes the same cascade of hormones that actual stress causes. Your endocrine glands appear to be unable to differentiate between an outside influence and the memory-induced influences caused by simply thinking of upsetting things. So now that you know what effect stress has on the body, imagine those same responses, such as overexertion of your cardiovascular system, on a consistent basis. That's why chronic stress is a risk factor for heart attacks and strokes. In addition, the perpetual high levels of cortisol causes impaired cognition, increase in abdominal fats, rapid weight gain, and a lowered immune system. So it's no surprise, then, that chronic stress is also a risk factor for diabetes, coronary artery disease, and why it increases your chance of getting sick. Chronic stress has also been shown to be a risk factor for countless other health problems such as depression, insomnia, anxiety, irritable bowel syndrome, substance abuse, sexual and reproductive dysfunction, headaches, and unexplained muscle and joint pain. So, now that you know the cause, how do you get rid of that stress? Simple on the surface, but often difficult to implement, the cure is just to remove or reduce the stressful input. Of course, it's easy to say I'm going to quit my stressful job, but homelessness and the inability to buy food, well, that's also extremely stressful. A much more practical way to get rid of stress, in many cases, is to find a way to get rid of the harmful hormones and metabolites that are created by the response. So, how do you do that? The body already has a natural way to settle down after a stressful encounter. It begins stimulating your parasympathetic nervous system. This is the rest and digest system that gets activated when, you guessed it, you rest or you begin digesting the food you just ate. As you can imagine, if you're thinking about stressful situations all day, your brain and body, they're not really resting. Strategies to combat chronic stress should include ways to promote relaxing, things like meditation, deep breathing exercises, muscle relaxation exercises, making time for recreation, and massage therapy. Even owning a pet has been shown to reduce stress. Sex is also a great way to stimulate your parasympathetic nervous system. For the ladies, also eating around 40 grams of dark chocolate a day has been shown to reduce perceived stress. If your personality tends towards excessive emotional responses to everyday things, screaming at the cars around you in a traffic jam because somehow that will make them move faster, countless studies have shown we can train our bodies to respond differently in those situations through behavioral therapy. If relaxing just isn't a part of your daily routine, there's another scientifically proven method to reduce excess cortisol in your body while giving you a boatload of other benefits, and of course, that's exercise. While exercise forces the body to increase cortisol levels due to our bodies perceiving this deviation from homeostasis as stress, regular exercise trains the body to reduce the amount of cortisol release when exposed to stress. For example, if you begin running at a 15-minute mile pace, your body will release the appropriate amount of cortisol for that experience. As you continue getting in better shape, less cortisol is needed to perform the same task. When you then come across stressful encounters in other aspects of your life, less cortisol is released in response to that input. The effect isn't limited to people who exercise. Several studies have shown those who regularly are more active see a decrease in cortisol release when exposed to an emotional situation compared to those who are sedentary. This is very similar to the result that psychologists are hoping for when they attempt desensitization techniques, continually exposing you to your stress in an attempt for you to have less of a reaction to it. Other things that have been shown to increase cortisol release are caffeine, alcohol, tobacco, sleep deprivation, and irregular sleep patterns. From this, you don't have to be a rocket surgeon to realize if you decrease your caffeine intake, stop drinking as much, and get better sleep, you will reduce the amount of cortisol circulating in your body. Grandma's advice, well, it's never been more correct. Eat right, get plenty of exercise, don't drink or smoke, go to bed on time, and find a way to make money doing what you love, and you're on track for a very low-stress life. If grandma's advice seems a little too tame, you can always try the scientifically proven method of combining sex and chocolate. So I really hope you found that video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. Also, if you're looking for something else from me, why not check out some videos from the archives on this channel, or check out my other channel called Top Tens. You'll find that linked to below. And as always, thank you for watching.